Well, thank you for those who stayed. This lay, you are being rewarded now with a bouquet of a flower. So kind of back to the old-fashioned trade of flower and bird paintings from the Chinese history. Well, I'll briefly talk about myself a little bit. I was born and raised in Taiwan, Taipei. Taipei is the city. And was educated there as well. I went to art school for the high school, actually, when I was 16, and studying packaging design. So I do have a commercial background. I worked for advertising for 2 years before I came over to the United States. So I came over here, I was 20, and now many, many years later, I'm working in an art institution. So, well, I think my painting are very straightforward. What you see is pretty much what you get. You're not really seeing anything else that's out of ordinary. But if you look very carefully, you see something that's completely wrong or very twisted. My work is usually interested in this kind of a new hybrid, manipulated by men. So the orchid and palm trees, but somehow it's been twisted. This piece is in the show. It's titled Las Vegas Series, or Las Vegas Cosmopolitan. You know what cosmopolitan is, it's a cocktail. So I think the idea is to illustrate the luxury of the kind of a decadent lifestyle in Las Vegas. Why Las Vegas, you may ask, right? Well, for me, if you see palm tree in the desert, that's completely fake. You know something's wrong, that's completely made up. So that's Las Vegas for you. And I think it's the glamour, the dazzling, the luxury, all the things that is kind of beyond, over the top, beyond the norm, are very much inspired me. And this is pretty much inspired by the showgirl performance. So think about the palm farm as the large feather fan, and the red flower is the performer on stage. Pink Lady is not a really good cocktail. It's no longer popular anymore, but I love the name. I think it's very fitting for Magnolia, and there he is. I do want to draw some of my kind of a cultural root, because I was definitely inspired by a lot of Chinese artists in history. Of course, I have to name somebody that has to share the same last name, Yun Shouping. Definitely, I'm related. If you believe me, I'm related. He's exactly from the history. I mean, for the ancestor history, he's on the 62nd generation. I'm 74, so that's a 12th generation ahead of me. And I was living under pressure because my family member telling me you should paint like him when I was little. So I think that gave a lot of influence, certainly. You know, I kind of was brought up in that kind of painting. We have a lot of books about Yun Shouping's style of painting, and he is known as one of the six masters in the early Qing Dynasty, roughly around, of course, you see the date right there. He's notoriously known for a style called the boneless style, the boneless. Familiar? Mogu, Hua Hui. So the way he does a piano, basically the boneless style means painting without the contour line. So I think if you look at the old, more of the old style of Chinese brush painting in terms of the floral genre, you'll see a lot of contour line or outline was literally drew before you do the color. My approach on the earlier day, these are dated back to probably 1994 to 96. So it's been about, what's my math like? Oh. 15 years ago, roughly, the color is more neutral. I think it's earthier. It has more of a brown sort of a color. It's more, it's not vivid. Unlike the work I showed you from the very beginning, it's that kind of saturated color. My earlier work was much more gentle. But I'm very into this kind of a positive and negative space where less is more. You don't just fill the image. Of course, another very inspiring figure is Giuseppe Castiglione. Well, I had to actually Google how to pronounce Italian. It's not easy. But I think his style completely knocked me down because I love his color. You know, every time when I compare his style versus some of the other masters from the Chinese flower and bird genre artists, I think his color is over the top. I loved it. Here's another three samples of Alan Shiling. He's an Italian missionary. I think if you were in the Monday's lecture, Wednesday night's lecture from UG, he briefly mentioned he's a missionary and came to China in 1715 at the age of 27. And he's definitely well-trained, born in Milan, and studied the European, Italian style of painting. my approach, sort of inspired by his palette, it was definitely jack up the color. Try to do very saturated imagery. I think this piece on the left are in particularly are sort of, I don't want to say mimicking, but kind of referencing to his style. Talk about a little bit of fusion here, because I think that's what the Across the Divide Symposium is for. It's about the culture dynamic, interchange or interaction. I am definitely adore Charles René McIntosh. Beautiful style. I think the simplification with the pattern and the solid color, it's just a different way of approaching, just very simple and elegant. My earlier work was printmaking, actually. I studied about 7 years, had an undergraduate degree at Cal State Long Beach. That's where UDU is teaching. And now, he wasn't there at the time when I was studying the printmaking from 95 to 97. But anyway, my earlier work was semi-abstract and with representational imageries, because I like the textures, I like the layering, I like the process. The labor-intensive routine really interests me. Here's another samples of Charles McIntosh's work. I think he's very good about incorporating pattern, using very simple geometric shapes, creating motions within a still life. And I think that was my interpretation, kind of inspired by him. I think a lot of those paintings were done without having those artists in mind. It was intuitive, it was done that way. I think these are just gonna draw from my library pool just to see what matches what, but I think they definitely play an important role. Another piece right here is done by, of course, Richard Diamond-Korn. I like his division. I think he divided space in a similar way, almost like some of the earlier Chinese brush painting I saw earlier. At the beginning of the presentation, the negative space and the positive space. So you have a lot of opening, as you can see, and then on the side, it's just all the kind of drama, and the main focus is kind of leaning to the side. But it still creates a harmony, so it has a good balance. It was my approach. These are date back to 97, so it's about 14 years ago. These are monoprints, and the way I did it, I used newsprint paper, and I rolled the ink on top and torn it, and used that as a printing template. And when you overlap, as you can see, the transparency started to show the layers. By the way, Richard Diamond-Korn is very well known for his Ocean Park series. For those, we have got a couple of students here, he's from the 1950s and 60s of abstract expressionism, and or as well as the Bay Area figurative movement. My approach, so the purely decorative, because I like nice things. I like things that look good. And so I thought, oh, that will be a very fitting title. There's really not a lot of content in mind. I'm not trying to make a statement. It was very simple, just for the, it was my exercise of dividing space, making image work. These are monoprints as well. And this is Into the Watercolor. I think about similar time, that's 97, so are these. These are dated the same year. I am pursuing watercolor for several reasons. One is the health reasons, because I think when I do printmaking for 7 years, I start to feel the chemicals wear me down, because I'm using a lot of toxic stuff. And before all the toxic-free material was introduced, this is in the early 90s. So I changed to watercolor, because I think unless you eat the paint, you should live forever, right? So. But I have the incorporation of the division of space in mind when I'm doing these. About a similar time, I started to think about creating a statement, certainly, because I've been challenged to do so in graduate school, because obviously my subject matter is something that looked pretty nice, something pretty, and like flower, for example. And I was kind of demanded to challenge that subject matter. So there is my resolution here. I'm taking the idea of a bonsai. The bonsai, as you already knew, is a potted plant originated from China. Now, what you're trying to do is also, you feel like you're doing a mini landscaping in a pot. So the main force over nature that intrigued me. Now, the background is a landscape as well. So the landscaping is the same idea. It's just outdoor, right? one's indoors, so you do it in a pot, you bring it to the house for decorations. But what you did to the tree, basically you did a lot of treatment to it. For example, you put a little bell to, not only for the look, for the beauty, but also it has a purpose. So you weigh down a branch to make a certain gesture, certain look, and you can clip it, trim it, and also you can wax to make the tree look like a 100-year-old tree. So the aging process is pretty, not normal, but it was pretty much treated by us, by men. I don't think I need to spend another 2 minutes talk about the significance of a red, because I think you already heard that many, many times by my colleagues here. It does have a significant component in my work as well. I think the idea is we're trying to make things that look better, and that was the idea. You start to tie things around and try to wrap in a certain way. This kind of a good fortune and happiness is also adopted here with a little twist. So I'm using the red robe as for two purposes here. One is for the metaphor of, you know, wishing well and all that. The other one is for the visual dynamic, the division, the direction, the balance, you know, all that kind of pictorial necessity, in my opinion, that after all, I'm painting an image. So I want to make sure this image works. As you can see, the flowers are kind of grafted to a branch that's unrelated to yourself, as well as being joined by, let's say this one has a little bit mini, you know, tangerines on the side, and then they all kind of grafted to this lumber right there where you can see if it's chiseled edge, you know who touched it. Again, it's artificial, it's not natural. So I do have that little bit of hint in case people still don't get it. They will see, okay, these I can see there's something wrong about it because it's being processed. Very similar idea on a triptych. And these are pretty small actually. They're 11 inches by 15 inches. And watercolor. I'm using transparent watercolors rather than gouache because I think I've been labeled as the purest, meaning that I don't want to cheat. I have to use everything that's watercolor that's just not opaque. And this is another one called The Landscape in a Bondo. This is in my graduate MFA thesis show back to 2000, roughly. And I thought it was interesting because I'm not sure about Wisconsin here, but I've seen tons of those in LA where they have those palm trees that's wrapped up in, you know, in bundles in the truck. They just plant it in the shopping center the next day, and then you know there's a 10-year-old tree right there on the location. So I thought that was kind of a provocative thinking. You know, the tree wasn't there last night, but now it's a 10-year-old tree right there. So I think the landscaping is really fascinating for me. It's completely artificial. Bouquet ready. I think I'm thinking about the consumerism, of course. Think about the immediacy. People want something fast, instant, quick, and just by the fact we're doing texting, we're doing emails and all that, just to want to get things more convenient. And I thought, well, I like the floral images. How can I kind of go to the next level? So I thought about think about bouquet that's actually being grown that way. So just go to the flower. You know, the florist, and there are choices for you, like combo number one, combo number two. Actually, I overnamed them was, in this case, the canna and orchid, there's a name, but actually there's a series right after is I use all the ice cream flavor for it, because ice cream has different, you know, referencing to colors and something like that. I have a vanilla for all the white flowers. So it just people, so I want everything that's white, so there's vanilla for you. So that's, you know, combo vanilla. And so I just assembled a flower, kind of flower on a stick concept. I notice everything's like on a stick, right? Hot dog on a stick, cheese stick on a stick, everything's on a stick. It's just so convenient for you to eat. So why not flower a bouquet on a stick? Back to that foundation of landscaping. So root, that's the foundation. But root means, of course, that in a naturalist term. I do think about, it was ironic, we're using natural resource to build nature. Think about it, park, garden. Right, and you're building in the landscaping, you're kind of mimicking the nature, but it's completely man-made. So all these lumber that's been processed or stretcher bar, I think usually when I show this to students, they recognize right away. So, hey, I assembled my first canvas, I recognize that. So that's the stretcher bar for you, and that's definitely processed too. Have you seen bird that built nest out of garbage? I've seen it. I made a big one here too. So as you can see, there are Coca-Cola cans or water hose. There's a, you probably are familiar if you drink coffee, and you know that lid right there. So I thought, well, why not to do that? So kind of again, based on my referencing to nature, and that's been kind of whether tarnished by us or as a collaboration. Not a piece. Well, this one was on a particular thing show I kind of featured in. It's kind of unrelated to some of the other work I was doing. They're trying to do a hat, and I create a hat for kind of a goddess from Arcadia, you know, back to the Greek mythology, and you're thinking that they're wearing those flower hats. I thought, try to picture your hat in the middle. Lately, I'm going more color. I'm trying to kind of think about why I was drawn onto painting flowers. I learned, well, not necessarily from a particular instructor, but I think over time, I got this idea, if you want to do realism, you want to paint something representational, let's say you want to paint food. If people think that looks so good, they want to eat, they feel hunger, you succeed. You succeed your painting. So I thought, well, flower, I cannot just spray something on it. So what I was thinking is the color can speak, can communicate to the audience, that you feel the vividness, the saturation, the color is so bright, it looks so real. That was my kind of concept in mind. So this is my current work. I'm going a little loose because, you know, I can't paint as tight as I usually can. I'm getting old too. So I feel like I want to do a little more expressive look. So, but still bring back to my my strength into the kind of a collaboration. So I think the pouring, that will be another topic because that's based on the landscape paintings from the Chinese art again. There's a lot of a genre, a movement. They do a lot of pouring paint, like Linan Hua Pai. So that's a movement right there for you. So the way they do their landscape painting or pour the paint, they're so lavish. The color is just beautiful. A lot of cobalt blue and cerulean. So I think that I had that inspiration in mind and combined with my flowers. So thank you.